In this video, I want to address some of the issues, the problem with the division that seems to be caused between members of the LDS Church through the direction and the example of the leadership towards people who become disaffected or non-believing of the faith. The vitriolic speech, hate speech, the labeling traitors and tyrants, anti-Mormon apostates, the type of labeling that has gone on since early in the church's history continues today to cause bad feelings of and feelings of mistrust, and tends to extend the black and white view of the world or of reality, portraying the church and its adherents and those who believe as good, and those who do not believe, especially if they once have, as evil or minions of the devil. And this is not unique to the LDS Church. This is probably common to many religions. I know the Jehovah's Witnesses use the same tactics and strategies, or many of them. And the Catholic Church, of course, we know burned people at the stake who decided they didn't believe in the Pope as the supreme human connection with God. So I want to take a look at maybe some of the beginnings of this as far as Mormonism goes. It's not a new thing. As I said, the Catholics practice this. And related to now, and maybe some situations I see, especially on the internet, and interactions that I may have with people who are of another belief at this time in their lives with regard to a belief in the restoration of the fullness of the gospel through Joseph Smith Jr. So, are all people who are believing that the church is true good or bad? Are all people that come to a belief and understanding, a realization that the assertion that Jesus Christ is a perfect being, all-knowing or an omniscient, and unchanging, as is stated in the Book of Mormon, and guides the LDS Church, yet seems to be making a lot of errors and can't seem to remember what he had inspired in one scripture to the next when he contradicts himself, not to mention the changing doctrines and the obfuscation of the Church's history. And continuing dishonesty on LDS.org, as I assert and as I demonstrate and document in various videos. So I just want to make a brief allusion here to, a recent encounter that I hope will continue and be a good one with someone who is involved with LDS apologetics, but is not the official apologist, and seems to be very probably an honest person. And I think there are probably a lot of people who are honest people who are or have been defending the church and its doctrines. However, some of them have, in the course of their defense of the church, come to find out that many of the claims made by those who were exposing or seeking to expose issues in the church which would tend to be contradictory to that assertion that an all-powerful, all-knowing, and unchanging God guided the church, these people are often named or labeled anti-Mormons, and that has become a loaded term because anyone who is so labeled by the church is considered, you know, a minion of Satan, an evildoer, a traitor, and the horrendous titles that are given to people who simply find that the evidence is not consistent with the story given by the church. So, we have the story that Joseph Smith was persecuted unjustly because people were guided by the devil to oppose, you know, the establishment of the kingdom of God. And that's the long and the short of what that line of thinking is. And so I went on this site, a very short YouTube, by someone with some impressive looking credentials who made a very short video, basically just to tell us that Joseph Smith probably just couldn't remember when he saw God. That's why he made so many different versions of the first vision, or something to that effect. I don't want to overly generalize it, but what I got out of it was, you know, it was difficult, but as time lapsed, his memory got keener, which is opposed to reality. So at first he just couldn't remember what year it was that he saw God face to face, and couldn't seem to associate it with various things that were going on in his life well enough to get the year straight. So, you know, sometimes he was 15, 16. According to Rigdon, he was 17, but then he said it was just the angel. And then finally he's 14, and God the Father shows up this time. So I thought, I didn't buy into a credentialed person trying to pass this off the way it was. And at any rate, I was contacted from that particular comment board by whom I thought was the professor, and there was an initial exchange or so, which wasn't real pleasant, probably between me and someone who was working to manage the website and is familiar, probably to a great degree, with LDS history. Don't know who this person is, but this person seems to be more human and reasonable than my perception would have been of the professing person of the facts, or not even facts in the video. Well, I think I'm rambling too much here. Basically, what I'm saying is we have perceptions of each other, and I posted, and I had an offhanded comment, you know, just mentioning Boyd K. Packer and telling the CES people that the whole truth isn't always useful. And I agree, it's not useful for the church's position to tell the whole truth. They need to obfuscate as much as possible the things that tend to bring to light the fact that an all-knowing, unchanging, just and holy God couldn't possibly be guiding the church, in my viewpoint. And I think I proved that pretty well in a lot of my presentations. So, you know, this person has, you know, said, well, why would you post something that you think is true? I was like, what kind of an assumption is that about me? Or my viewpoint, do I think that Boyd K. Packer would never say anything that's true? Well, I don't think he'd say much that's not useful to the LDS corporate empire, but it could be true what he said. Many things he said could be true. I don't believe many things that he did say. I do believe that he didn't, now that he's dead. I don't think he believed the things that he taught. I think that these men know that they don't see Jesus Christ, and that they're faking it as special witnesses, as he claimed to be. When he said, we do not divulge the details of the interviews that qualify us to be special witnesses of his name. And I heard him say that, but we have them. And I thought, okay, he's basically saying that he's seen the Lord, that is, you know, portrayed by the church, the Lord. And I don't think he did believe that, but who's to say? Well, when we look at the contradictions, when we look at the track record of these people, we see a pattern. And we don't have to hate one another if we have a different viewpoint of things. There's what I would call an awakening process, and a lot of the videos have been posted with people's stories of how they woke up. And John DeLynn did his initial presentation on why Mormons leave the church, why people stop believing, and I would say that his viewpoint appears to me to have changed. He thought the church leaders were pretty innocent back then, and I'm not sure that he believes the same thing now. But he discussed important issues, such as how people are stereotyped as, oh, they just quit the church because they're weak, they're unfaithful, they wanted to use drugs and chase women they weren't married to, and or men that, you know, they weren't married to, and they just wanted to be wicked, they were not worthy to be members of the church. They just wanted to sin. Things like that. To stereotype, because everyone needs to fit things into their belief system. And your belief system, if it says that, you know, if you do the right things, if you follow certain rules in the church, which are called commandments, then the result will be that the Holy Spirit will be with you and strengthen your testimony and you won't fall away. You must have been doing something wrong. A long time ago, I had this experience, and we were teaching this investigator couple, and they were about to, they were considering a divorce or something. It wasn't a long teaching experience. And I remember telling them, well, one of you must have hearkened to Satan, you know? And because otherwise you should be able to manage to continue in a good relationship. And, you know, maybe that's pretty true, I think, but that goes along with that, you know, keeping it within the belief system. You must have violated the commandments in order to lose the spirit, to not have your testimony, to be deceived by these horrible, wicked deceivers that put distorted material on the internet in anti-Mormon literature. I'm sorry, folks. I got things straight out of the scriptures and from my experiences and was able to think and see contradictions that were not reconcilable. Did I ever run into some things like people, John DeLynn? Yes, but he wasn't marketing a bunch of phony baloney. Everything that I looked at is provable from LDS sources. So people have different views because they learn more information. It doesn't mean that they're evil. But many LDS apologists are very dishonest. Because once you see the truth, you either have to be so mind-controlled that you can't see it, or you have to be honest and say, you know what, it's not like they told us in Sunday school. At least that's how I see it. In the meantime, let's not name-call each other. Let's try to look at the facts and discuss them without the name-calling, the labeling. Critics, anti-Mormons, apostates. Why not drop the labels?
I know what it's like to feel like you are being attacked when, say, the local Baptist church would have cult week and show that Mormons were part of a cult. You feel like it's attacking you personally, when really the leadership is using mind control techniques in various religions, Jehovah's Witnesses, Scientology, the Moonies, and yes, we can see evidence of it in Mormonism. It may not be as dramatic, nevertheless, coercive persuasion is used, and we need not feel that the members are some sort of bad people, and they need not be labeled badly, as we see some videos do on the internet. They say Mormons are satanic, then they'll show connections with the occult, and then try to make it look like the average member of the church is some sort of, you know, devil worshiper, which is absurd. It only serves to discredit. Now we see people that are labeled anti-Mormon and that really are part of, say, the born-again Christian movement, or working with it or profiting from marketing materials to the born-again Christians about Mormons, and some of this material is false. And of course it gives credence to church apologists to say, hey, these guys, you know, they say things that aren't true about the church, and they do say things that are not true or not verifiable or, you know, are twisted. However, some of the things that they say are, depending on who it is, are definitely true. And I've seen videos that said, okay, Mormons are Satanists or satanic. And it's a horrible label. And, you know, they show an inverted pentagram and so forth on it. And then they get into the video, and most of what they said was accurate, actually. But the inference is that the average Latter-day Saint is some sort of person into Satanism, you know, knowingly. And it's ridiculous, and it's wrong. So there are those who have earned the label of liars, who have exaggerated things about members of the church and various practices. The God Makers, or some of these Mormon, you know, these cartoons that portray and extrapolate upon teachings that you may have seen in the writings of James Talmage, for instance, and then they extrapolate upon them to make it sound like this is what the average member of the church believes. You know, God coming down and having sex with Mary, or saying that you'll have 1,000 polygamist wives on your own planet. You know, you should be able to have a planet eventually. In Mormon theology, it seems logical, but 1,000 wives? I've really never seen anything that would indicate that should necessarily be the case, although Brigham did teach that celestial marriage or polygamy was necessary to becoming a god. The numbers don't work out very well unless many more of the women are more righteous than the men. So there are fallacies on both sides of that coin, but most people who leave the church, or many of them, because of the fact that they find that things are not as they were told, should not be characterized as people who just left because they were weak or wicked or wanted to sin. And they have been falsely characterized, as people have been falsely characterized since the beginning, when Joseph Smith was screaming, you know, he was innocent and everyone else was a persecutor and evil. I think the facts point to, you know, people like William Law being moral and good people who took a stand against what they perceived was wrong with Joseph Smith's practices with concubinage. Smear tactics are just wrong. They're made to discredit people rather than discussing the issues candidly, which Joseph Smith was not in a position to do because he was not in the right and he had not been honest.
You heard it on the Dodger Game Channel on Mormon Truth Videos.